I don't always drink beer, but when I do, let's face it, I'm always drinking beer. I'm Dustin Brighter, and this is BrewTall Geek, the show where a geek who's tall takes you through brews. Let's have a drink. What we have here is a modern stout glass. Now, a lot of stouts are served in bars in no-neck pint glasses or in tulip glasses or goblets, specifically to let the wide mouth give a large, large smell and aroma to the beer while you drink it, giving you those nice chocolate notes that stouts are famous for. This glass, on the other hand, was designed by German company Spiegelau, who has been around for 500 years, perfecting the art of making beer in wine glasses. They make the glass ultra smooth through a process they call platinum, which is when they push the liquid glass through platinum tubes. They worked with Left Hand Brewing and Rogue Brewing to create the perfect stout glass. A nice little base here to make sure it doesn't fall over, a little bit of a stem almost, and the tulip top, which really pulls those aromas into your nose. Today we have a Samuel Smith Imperial Stout we're gonna pour in here. Let's get started. Now, pouring a stout from a bottle and pouring a stout from a tap are very different things. I tend to angle my glass and pour in slowly, whereas a proper bar will have what's called a slow pour spigot, which will pour the stout at the correct temperature and rate to make sure that you don't foam up too much or not get the flavor you're looking for. That looks beautiful. This is called a no-nick pint glass. Like most pint glasses, it holds a pint. However, unlike other pint glasses, it has this nice bubble ridge here. Now that serves multiple purposes. One, it allows for you to get a larger area for the beer to sit, which for brown ales and stuff can open up the aromas, the flavors really, really well. But also, it is much harder to drop a no-nick pint glass due to that ridge, which is one of the reasons it was invented. Today, we have a very standard Newcastle brown ale that we're gonna pour into this no-neck pint glass. Now, like most beers, you wanna pour slow, watch the head as it comes through to make sure you're getting enough. Now, a lot of these bottles I'm using are 12-ounce bottles, which is smaller than a pint, but you can still see the nice coloring it gets, decent head. Nice standard beer for a nice standard pint glass. This is a rare glass you probably won't see in a bar or pub. The slight bulb here and small taper towards the top make this an ideal glass for almost any lighter colored beer. Pilsners, lagers, pales, even IPAs can go well in this glass. You could get away with a wheat beer, but you're probably better off using the standard Hefeweizen glass for that. Today I'm going to be using Omission Pale. This is a great brewery, gluten removed, really flavorful beers, always that 45 degree angle to make sure that you're not agitating the beer too much. And there we are. Now we're going to move away from what beers go to what glasses and into how to treat your glassware. Chilled glasses you'll find in a lot of American bars. They are phenomenal for American lagers like Budweiser, Coors. They're great for American Pilsners. Things that don't have a lot of flavor or don't have a great flavor can be well enhanced by chilling your glass. The problem with chilling the glass for other beers, though, is that the minute imperfections in the way that the water freezes on the inside of the glass will agitate the beer in a way that you are not expecting. You're going to get more head, you're going to waste a lot of beer, it's going to taste different. I, for one, don't chill my glasses. Unless I'm drinking what my father-in-law calls a lawnmower beer. Then it's beautiful. As much trouble as it might be, always hand wash your beer glasses. The residue left by some soaps and detergents in dishwashers can leave tiny imperfections that will either change the taste of the beer because there's leftover detergent, or will agitate the beer, leading you to drinking a foamy, foamy, disgusting mess. In that same vein, you should allow your beer glasses to air dry, because towel drying them can also leave tiny, small pieces of cloth or fabric in there, which you won't taste, but will agitate your beer. As you can see, there are a lot of choices when it comes to beer glasses. You can choose to drink your beer out of whatever you want, whether it's a no-neck pint or even a horn. Most people, when they think of Belgian beers, they think of the standard double, triple, quadruple. The nice, light, crisp Belgian ales that get a very high alcohol content the further you go up that rate. What they don't think about a lot of the time is the other beers that come from Belgium. Belgian wit beers or wheat beers. Lambics, which are very interesting as they're spontaneously fermented. So basically the barrel is just left open to the elements and any yeast or bacteria in the air can move on in and start the fermentation process. Now that might sound gross to you, but it's the same way sourdough bread's made. Another style that Belgium is really known for is the saison or farmhouse ale, which is a sour ale. There are three types of lambic. Straight lambic, which comes straight from the barrel. Fruit lambics, which have fruit added later in the process to give them a sweet, fruity taste. And gozes. Gozes are made up of mixing an old beer with a younger beer. It kind of balances out the flavors of the fruit lambics and straight lambics. When looking into Belgian beers, you're also going to come across two terms, Trappist and Abbey. Trappist means that the beer was crafted, created, and brewed by Trappist monks in a monastery. There are very stringent rules to what can be considered Trappist and not, sort of like Champagne for France. Abbey ales, on the other hand, are not brewed by Trappist monks. It basically is the term for any Belgian beer that's made not in that tradition. This could be a brewery from the United States, or even one in Belgium that just doesn't use Trappist monks or the monastery. Belgian monks have been brewing beer for hundreds of years, all the way back to 1000 AD, possibly 750 AD. It's a long time. Many Belgian beers are what's called bottle conditioned. Bottle conditioning is when you introduce yeast to the beer after it's bottled. Basically allowing the yeast to continue eating the sugars of the beer while it's in its bottle. This can lead to higher ABV, this can lead to smoother tasting beer, and a finer, more refined flavor. This also helps with carbonation. As the yeast is eating the sugar and producing, it will continuously carbonate the beer. Now we're gonna dive into my favorite Belgian beers, doubles, triples, and quads. Doubles traditionally score very low on the IBU count, which means that they have a very low bitterness. But you are going to taste some chocolate notes and some toffee notes when you're sampling a double. In keeping with the traditions of the area, a double is best accompanied by some good sausage. Triples are called triples because they contain triple the amount of grain that a normal beer needs to ferment. These usually come in at a higher percentage than doubles, somewhere around 7 to 10%. The spicy floral aroma and light bitterness of a triple pair it perfectly with ham dishes. Quadruples, or quads, are the stronger cousins to the doubles and triples. It's usually a dark brown to an amber color, with a very complex flavor, almost as complex as wines. The dark sweet flavors of the quadruples put them in the same classification as barley wines, for me personally. Quads go very well with sweet desserts, things like bread pudding, but if you want a more savory instead of sweet, try it with a strong cheese like Gouda. The Belgian I selected today is from Unibrow Brewing in Canada. This is their Mod 8. Now, being in Canada and not being brewed by Trappist monks, this would be considered an Abbey ale. You'll also see a lot of Belgians in the quads and triples corked almost like champagne. The reason for this is the re-fermentation in the bottle can cause excess pressure, which can very easily blow off a bottle cap, but it's much harder to do with a cork and wire. Let's open her up. The first thing you'll notice on this double is the deep amber red color of the beer and the very rocky head that forms. First thing I'm gonna do, give it a smell. Getting a lot of floral hops, wild spices. It smells delicious. Time to taste. It's very spicy, very malty. A little bit of that hop bitterness on the back end. Just barely. Like I mentioned before, this beer would probably go really well with some chocolate. But honestly, like a complex wine, it'd be perfectly at home next to a steak as well. Oktoberfest started as a festival to celebrate the marriage of King Ludwig, then the Crown Prince, to a princess whose name is long and almost impossible for me to pronounce. 5 days after the wedding, they held a huge festival outside of one of the large gates of the city of Munich, and since then, traditionally, it has been celebrated every year. Oktoberfest, in its over 200-year tradition, has only been canceled 24 times, including this year due to the coronavirus pandemic. Most of the time that it's been closed has been due to war, cholera outbreaks, or disease of some other kind. It really takes a lot to get the Germans to stop drinking beer. I get that. Something that makes Oktoberfest really special to me, and to a lot of beer drinkers out there, is that it's one of the only festivals that actually has its own beer style. You'll see a lot of different names for the same beer. Oktoberfest beer, Fest beer, spelled both B-E-E-R and B-E-I-R. Marzen is another name for them. Now, the Marzen style, which means March in German, has been around for longer than Oktoberfest. But those beers tended to be used for Oktoberfest because they were brewed in the springtime, and by the time they were ready to be served, it was about October, about time for the festival. But in recent years, it's been started in September, specifically because the weather is just better. Because Oktoberfest is a Bavarian holiday, not necessarily a German holiday, the only breweries that are allowed to be officially served at Oktoberfest are breweries found inside of Munich. Currently, there are 6 official breweries for Oktoberfest: Augustiner, Löwenbräu, Hofbräuhaus, Polliner, Hackershore, and Spaten. These are the only beers that are allowed to be served at the Oktoberfest festival. Marzens or Fest beers are a very full-bodied ale that can range in color from dark amber to all the way up to pale. Hofbräuhaus's Oktoberfest is a very pale straw-colored Oktoberfest, whereas Samuel Adams' Oktoberfest is a very dark brown color. While these beers are still associated with Oktoberfest and called Oktoberfest or Fest beers, the tradition of serving them due to their long shelf life no longer being used. Since the long shelf life of Marzen beers really doesn't come into play with modern refrigeration and things like that, Oktoberfest beers, or Fest beers, or Marzens, have seen a decline in Oktoberfest in drinking. You really don't find too many actual Fest beers there anymore. The first Fest beer we have is from Bavarian brewery Eyinger. Let's go ahead and take it out. Another light Marzen. Nice light amber color, not too light, not straw like Hofbräu, not too dark. You can definitely smell the malt, a little bit of wheat and yeast. Very malty taste on the front. A little bit of bitter in the back, caramel notes. Now I'm craving sausages. The next one that we have, this Marzen comes from Weihenstephaner Brewery, the oldest running brewery in the world, established in 1040 AD. Both of these beers were also brewed in accordance to the Bavarian Purity Law of 1516, meaning they only include 3 ingredients other than yeast, which is water, hops, and malt. It smells a lot less malty than the Eyinger did. Head's got a very specific taste. I don't want to say it, but the head almost tastes like drinking a Heineken. Getting a little bit of the malt in the back, not quite as malt forward as I would like. I would honestly pair this with a crisp salad, maybe something with cranberries in it. It has a very crisp taste that I think would lend very well to some kind of crunchy light food. The next beer we have up isn't a Fest beer at all. Instead, it's a Dunkel, or a German dark lager. Usually dark brown, dark amber to a reddish brown color is their range. Not too high, not too low in the alcohol percentages. Now these beers, Dunkels, are known for being extremely smooth and malty. Very, very malty. Crisp though. It's almost as if somebody made a stout into a lager. There's a lot of taste in here, a lot of taste playing on the tongue. This would probably go really well with like a stew. Get the beef and vegetables to really bring out the complexities in the beer. Now I can't talk about German beers in general without bringing up a few German beer cocktails. I worked for a while at a German restaurant as a bartender, and I learned that traditionally there are German beer cocktails. For instance, this is what's called a Cola Weizen, or Coke and Hefeweizen. People also mix Coke and wine, which I thought was crazy until I tried it. Now you can see it darkened the beer quite a bit. There's a little bit of the straight cola floating on the bottom there. Gives it a really pretty feel, and as it bubbles, it's going to mix itself in, but we're gonna take a drink. The Coke just adds that extra little flavor. I'm not even sure how to explain it, but if you have Coke and Hefeweizen in the house, it's worth a try. Now I haven't found Cola Weizen packaged in that way, but you can find some other beer cocktails pre-packaged. This is called a Radler. What a Radler usually is juice mixed with beer. This one is basically a lager, or a light beer, mixed grapefruit. Almost like a summer shandy can be a lager, or a wheat beer mixed with a little bit of citrus. A lot of citrus here, a lot of grapefruit. Oh, that tastes like candy. There's no sourness of the grapefruit. You're not getting any of that puckering. Just a crisp lager with a nice grapefruit citrus undertone.
Yo.
How's it going? This is BrewTall Geek, and I'm Dustin Brighter. With fall and Halloween upon us, pumpkin-flavored everything is upon us as well. Today we're going to be going over some pumpkin or just spooky Halloween beers. Here we have Night Owl. Night Owl is brewed by Elysian Brewing. In addition to the pale, Munich, and crystal malts, which make up the malt profile for Night Owl, each batch is brewed using 150 pounds of pumpkin. Pumpkin in the mash, the boil, and the fermenter. And it's also brewed using green and roasted pumpkin seeds. Horizon hops are used to bring a balance and a little bit of bitterness into the mix. Some of you may notice that I very heavily favor a tulip glass for tastings. Hazy, copper orange, amber pour. Head's like a khaki tannish color. Not seeing very much lacing in the beginning, but that might increase over time. The head is also flattening out over time, definitely. Smelling a lot of spice and, not surprisingly, a lot of pumpkin. While the pumpkin flavor is definitely here, it's pushed aside a bit by the sheer power of the spices in this brew. Overall, it is not a bad pumpkin ale. 6.7% though, packs a little bit of a punch. Here we have Dark of the Moon by Elysium. Pumpkin stout, and at 7.5%, it's a decent hitter. And even though it's brewed with a slew of malts, it's the pumpkin that again goes in the mash, the kettle, and the fermenter. Stout glass. Now the beer was bittered with Magnum hops and finished with crushed cinnamon. It was a very dark brown, almost black looking, very, very thin yellow tan head to it. Much less retention than a regular stout. A little bit of lacing on the sides there, if you can see that. I'm smelling toasted malts. Some notes of chocolate. I can barely even smell any pumpkin. It's not an over-strong, like, pumpkin flesh feeling to it, which you can get from some of the other pumpkin ales. So like a lot of stouts, this beer will change profile, taste, and smell as it warms up. There's a lot of chocolate in there. That almost tastes like biting into a chocolate bar. A little bit of bitterness on the back end, thanks to those Magnum hops, which are doing a great job of covering up that pumpkin flavor. Really toasty, a little bit of inter-caramel. Got a lot of cinnamon on the back of the tongue. It's really not as thick as a lot of stouts. It's kind of medium body. But Dustin, you say, I'm a celiac. I'm allergic to wheat. I can't have beer. Well, luckily for you, if you're a fan of pumpkin, Ace makes a pumpkin cider. Now, this is an interesting cider, as it is a pumpkin cider, but it is an apple cider flavored with pumpkin spice. It's very easy to tell. This is an apple cider flavored with pumpkin spice, as it pretty much tastes like a green apple cider with allspice in it. I think a lot of beer fans will think it's a little bit too sweet. This would probably be really, really good mixed into a cocktail for Halloween or like a Halloween punch bowl. Yeah, if you're gluten-free, don't like beer, or are just a sucker for sweet drinks, Ace Hard Pumpkin Cider might be for you. So much apple. So much. This is Shipyard Brewing Company's Smashed Pumpkin. It's pumpkin ale with natural pumpkin flavor. Now, what's crazy about this one is they actually list the hops and malts used on the back of their can. Willamette and Saphir hops kind of mingle with Two Row British Pale, malted wheat, light Munich malts, and a bit of pumpkin to create what a lot of people consider to be a top fermented masterpiece. This is the only beer today that actually has a recommended serving temperature. They say it's best enjoyed at around 55 degrees. Got really nice crisp carbonation sound when you open that can. It's a good sign. Wearing like a deep tawny cover almost. Reddish hue, but pretty transparent. Head seems to be maintaining very nicely in this fancy mason jar made by Lagunitas. The head's pretty thick still, but it's definitely fizzling out on the pour. I can see it kind of going down. I agitated the beer a little bit too much on this pour. Even experts make mistakes. Really getting like a ethanol, those ethanol esters. A little bit of pumpkin notes, but a lot of breadiness from the malt. I'm almost smelling banana. All right, a lot of pumpkin, allspice, almost like brown sugar or molasses in there. That is a well done beer. It's a really smooth, easy drinking beer, which honestly might make this one a little bit dangerous. As a 9% beer, feels a little low in alcohol in the taste. The more you get into it, the stronger the cinnamon flavor, it kind of builds, almost like it stays on your tongue. While the taste and smell seem to belie the ABV of this beer, definitely shows up in the mouthfeel. Really strong in the sip and fades near the end, but it's very, very crisp and fresh. That's a great beer. Now, I said earlier that I would be doing this episode on pumpkin beers and spooky or Halloween-themed beers. And this next beer is the only reason why I said that. Here's what Stone has to say about their Enjoy By series.
We brew this intense double IPA with more than 10 different hops, employing hop bursting and dry hopping techniques to amp up the peach and tropical fruit notes and overall hop factor. Brewed specifically not to last, this devastatingly fresh golden beauty should be enjoyed within 37 days. Now, for those of you that don't know, beers do have a best buy date for the most part. Beers that can be cellared, bottle conditioned, don't usually have a best buy or expiration date, but most other beers do. Many breweries will go around with their distribution teams and remove beer that is past the best buy date and replace it with fresh beer. However, Stone is extremely militant about that, to the point of even having a place on their website where you can tell them about expired beer that you found in your store. Stone already had a very, very short day period, which was 150 days. If it's been 150 days, it will be replaced or it was already bought. Taking that down to 37 days is insane. It means that all of the beer that they brew for the Enjoy By for that batch has to be bottled, canned, taken to the stores, distributed, sold, and consumed within 37 days. By far, the shortest period of any beer or any brewery. Now, I said before that they use 10 different hops in this. Nugget, Super Kalina, Simcoe, Delta, Target, Amarillo, Cascade, Galaxy, Citra, Nelson Sauvin, Matupet, and Helga. That's a lot of hops.
Really, really sharp exhale of air, but not very long, not too much carbonation.
So, really light, clear golden hue with a small bit of haze that diminishes as soon as you pour it. The head is thick and off-white, and it's kind of slowly dying in large pockets to probably gonna settle out as a thin skin across the top. There's a lot of strands of lacing already before I've even taken a drink. Now, as you can see, they used a jack-o'-lantern for the gargoyle this time. So, Halloween. That has nothing to do with me wanting to drink a 9.4% IPA. There's a very strong smell of pine, fresh-cut citrus, tropical fruit. I use citrus wood a lot at my campfire, so that might be a strange thing for people to know. A little bit of solvent. There's a lot going on in this. As expected from a beer brewed with 10 different kinds of hops, the taste is hugely hoppy. It's a lot of citrus on the tongue, pine, getting some tropical fruit, some peach, which I think they said, and a little bit of pineapple almost, but it's balanced by a bready malt flavor. It's got a very pointed, bitter, almost grapefruit-like finish. You get the pine throughout the entire taste. Probably a slightly below average carbonation. This is definitely a nice, slow-sipping, savoring beer if you can get a nice stemmed glass so you're not warming up the IPA. This is a great addition to the Enjoy By series. Many Hefeweizens are still brewed in accordance to the German Purity Law of 1516. That's a law that stated only three ingredients could be used to make beer: water, barley, and hops. They added yeast later once they realized that that's what actually helps the fermentation process, but a lot of beers are still brewed that way. The first beer I've got up is the Oettinger Hefeweizen. A little bit of bitterness on the back end, sweetness in the beginning. Now, when pouring a Hefeweizen, you want to make sure that you tilt the glass at about a 45 degree angle. Pour slow as you watch the beer coming into the glass so you can keep an eye on how large the head is getting. That's getting a little too big. Even the best of us screw up. The Oettinger is a nice cloudy straw color with a nice shock white head. Let's give it a taste. A little bit sweet on the nose, a bit of hops in the middle there, and it kind of finishes with a little bit of a bitterness to it. This Hefeweizen would go really well with some German Weisswurst, sausages, pretzels, cheese dips, that kind of a thing. Any kind of Oktoberfest fare, this beer would go great with it. The Oettinger is one of the beers that is still brewed in accordance with the German Purity Laws of 1516. It's got a simplistic taste, very, very natural flavors for a Hefeweizen. Not going too crazy or anything like that out there, but just under 5.5%, it's pretty drinkable. You can have a few, it's a great beer. The second beer on the chopping block today, or tasting block rather, is Pollinger Hefeweizen. Pollinger is a brewery based out of Munich, Germany. Being so, they are one of the only six breweries that are allowed to be sold at the Oktoberfest festival. Pollinger still brews in accordance to the Bavarian Purity Law of 1516. That means that the only ingredients in this beer are water, hops, barley, and yeast.
Always with that 45 angle, nice and slow. You don't want to rush it. That agitates the beer, creates a lot more head than you want. Now, the head is an important part of the beer, especially in a German beer. It carries a different taste, and a taste that mixes very well with the beer itself. Just on the nose, I'm getting a little banana, a little bit of almost bubblegum kind of yeastiness. A little bit of a darker straw than the Oettinger. A very nice color, cloudy as well. It's highly carbonated, especially for a Hefeweizen. A lot of bubbles in here. A little bit of a bitterness on the back end, just like the Oettinger was. Almost spicy. It's a little bit of a cop-out, as it is a staple of German food, but again, this would go great with Weisswurst, Spätzle, any kind of schnitzel, chicken or pork schnitzel, smoked hams. I can see this paired with richer seafood as well, scallops or lobster maybe. Polliner's been doing it for a very long time. They're good at what they do. Now this last beer might be a bit of a cheat. It's not technically a Hefeweizen, but I did say German wheat beers in the beginning, specifically to drink this one. This is one of my favorite beers in the entire world. Weihenstephaner Vitus. Yes, Weihenstephaner. It's brewed on a hill called Weihenstephan. Breweries aren't that clever sometimes. And one of the cool things about Weihenstephaner is that they are the oldest brewery that's still operating in the world. They were created in 1040 AD, which means they'll be celebrating their 1,000 year anniversary in 20 years. That's gonna be one hell of a party. You think Oktoberfest is crazy. Now I'm a big fan of Hefeweizens and wheat beers in general. Makes it a little difficult for me. My wife's allergic to wheat. We don't really keep them in the house very often. So I use this as an excuse to buy the Vitus. If the Polliner and the Oettinger Hefeweizens were your mom's Toyota van, the Weihenstephaner Vitus is a Ferrari 488. This is what's called a Weizenbock. It's basically a mixture of a Bock and a Weissbier, or a wheat beer. The reason I say that there's that big of a difference between these beers is that while it might not look like it, the Weihenstephaner Vitus is packed with a lot of flavor and 7.7% alcohol. This is one of the only wheat beers that I have found with an alcohol percentage usually reserved for IPAs. Get a lot of wheat smell, a little bit of fruit. So the Weizenbock, or at least the Weihenstephaner Vitus specifically, doesn't really taste like a regular German Bock beer. It tastes more like a fruity Hefeweizen, which means that a 7.7% beer goes down a little too easy, if you get my meaning. It's got a very effervescent feel in your mouth, high carbonation, a lot of bubbles. I would probably pair this with red meats, steaks, strong cheeses. So probably pair well with some dessert pastries as well. Apple tarts, apple turnovers, apple strudel. Apple would be a very good taste with this. You don't get any of the citrus that you get from American wheat beers or the lemon peel that you get from some Hefeweizens. I'm not getting any banana or clove hints in here at all, which means they didn't inherit that from the Hefeweizen side. That about sums it up for Hefeweizens. Today the four pack that I bought has their Mustang IPA, Mustang being the mascot of Cal Poly Slow, and three of their Hefeweizens, Mango, Tropical, and Blood Orange. Me being a big Hefeweizen fan, I think I'm gonna have fun with these. Let's grab them open. This is the Mango. A heavier carbonation than I would expect from Hefeweizen, to be perfectly honest. So it pours a nice golden color with that hazy Hefeweizen look you got. But like I said, there's quite a bit of carbonation on this one. Oh man, that is just mango. There's not much Hefeweizen smell there. There's no weediness, there's no clove, no banana. It's got a little bit of light, it's kind of spotty lacing, but it disappears pretty quickly. The head is really dense. I'm sticking around for a lot. Retention's really high on this one. I mean, mango and orange, a lot of fruit. Not a lot of Hefeweizen in this. This might actually be a really great beer for somebody to try if they're into seltzers and is trying to start branching out into beers or something like that. This is the mango seltzer of beers. That being said, it's delicious, so what can you do? So the head disappears almost immediately upon pouring it. It was a nice kind of dense white when it was poured, which I missed that footage, sorry. But it kind of fizzled down very quickly to about a quarter of an inch and then sort of capped out. It's pretty bright orange, which makes sense for being blood orange. It's pretty opaque too, I can't really see through it. There's a little bit of patchy, spotty lacing, as you can see. It goes pretty quickly. It almost smells like orange candy. The orange is really tart, really strong. Yeah, that is an orange beer. It starts pretty bold, but it fades a little bit kind of midway in, and it kind of tastes a little like orange candy flavor. Its carbonation is a little bit lower than the mango, but it's still got a very, very crisp mouthfeel. Starts kind of semi-sweet, finishes tart. These are basically shandies is what they are. Just mango and blood orange instead of lemon. These would be delightful on a hot day, poolside or beachside shower. Just like the other one, I'm not getting very much of a Hefeweizen feel from this. It's a shandy. It's a shandy. But it's a delicious shandy. Next up, we have the Tropical POG. That's a passion fruit, orange, guava. Kind of expecting this one to be the same as the other two in that it's more
more of a shandy than a traditional Hefeweizen, which makes sense for the tropical flavors. But the last two have been delicious. I have no complaints. So without further ado, let's get our tropics on. That is a tropical flavor. Head's very light, very airy, real thin. Its retention's really high, but on your mouth, it dissipates almost immediately. It just completely melts. Oh, wow. Oh, yeah. The guava is interesting because I want to say it's the strongest flavor, but I also want to say it's the lightest flavor at the same time. It's about the same amount of carbonation as the other ones, which again leads me to believe they're probably all based off of the same Hefeweizen recipe. Got a little bit more body and a little bit more flavor than the other two, to be honest. And maybe that's because you're using three different fruits on this one instead of just mango or just blood orange. This might be my favorite one out of the three so far. It's not as much of a shandy as the other two are. It's almost like a wheat lambic. It's almost like they just brewed a fruit beer out of guava,
passion fruit,
and orange. It is flavorful. On to the IPA. Founded in 1988, meaning it's as old as I am, Slow Brew is one of California's longest-standing brew pubs. In fact, it's the first brew pub that opened after Prohibition. Now you can find them as the Carissa in downtown San Luis Obispo. From there, it's a quick 10 minutes or so to The Rock, or Slow Brew Rock. Their 30-barrel brew house, canning line, and taproom restaurant. Never one to stay stagnant, The Rock also now boasts their new craft distillery, Rod and Hammer's Slow Stills. That brings us to their Mustang IPA, their most award-winning beer. At 7.1%, the Mustang IPA isn't a low plus. It's definitely got a bit of a punch to it. So, pours a bit of an amber, nice kind of translucent amber, to be honest. I can see my fingers through the glass, and it looks like lacing's gonna be present on the drink time, but we'll find out. Really strong hop smell, a little bit of lemon, and citrus with hints of pine. Almost like a pine turkey. Strong hop taste with a really, really punching bitter back note. Probably stems from what I think is citrus rind. The lemon comes out really strong in the middle, covering up what seems to be malt attempting to come through, but it's having a rough time of it. And it's a little bit peppery on the back end. I almost would want this with like an arugula salad. As crazy as that might sound. Oh, that's delicious. Can't really tell that it's 7.1% either. This could very easily be 5.5%. But it's not. First up, we have Bell's Christmas Ale. This is a Scotch Ale, so I'm a little excited. It's been a while since I've had one. This is crafted with ESB malt, rye malt, flaked wheat, fresh pine needles, yes, real pine needles. I'm hoping that there's a little bit more of a pine taste than the mammoth stuff, and Belgian Saison yeast. Bell says that the basic inspiration for this ale was to create a sessionable holiday brew, which makes perfect sense considering it's 7.5%. Obviously, that was sarcasm. They use custom-made, locally grown malt in the hopes that this ale would stand apart from the onslaught of spiced wines, ciders, and other beers that are out there for the season. This beer actually contains no spices at all and gains all of its flavor from the malted barley. So it's poured a bit of a opaque, reddish-brown, kind of a dark amber color. It's got a really thick, creamy head on it. Doesn't really recede, and it leaves very, very thick lacing. Getting toasted grains, definitely that buttery maltiness and toffee. Other people have said they sense cherry in the smell, but I'm not smelling any cherry whatsoever. Ooh, definitely getting toffee, caramel, a little bit of that cherry on the back of the tongue, but this is about the flavor profile of a stout almost, which is traditionally winter cold weather beer. It's medium bodied, it's a little dry, honestly. I think this is what a Christmas beer should be. This would go good with almost any traditional Christmas dinner. It's gonna pair well with a lot of meats. Good job, Bells. Next up, we have the Golden Road Christmas Cart. This is coming out of a can, so it's gonna be a little bit of a different taste from a lot of the bottles that I'm normally used to doing. This is a wheat ale that is, I believe, spiced with cherries and spices. Nutmeg, cinnamon, allspice. It is a fruit cart, so it is a wheat beer with fruit mixed, which is, I guess, the cherries for this one. So it's an interesting choice. Oh, that definitely looks like cherry. That looks like a cider. It pours a bit of a reddish amber color. Really translucent. I'm getting no head at all on this one. Oh, wow. I'm not smelling the cherries again in this one, but I am smelling cinnamon, nutmeg, cloves, and allspice. See if it tastes like cherries. A little bit of tartness on the back end, but it's sweet, and you definitely get all of those Christmas spices. It's very, very heavily on the spice. It doesn't really taste like a beer, to be honest. If you consider this more like a Christmas spiced cider, it might make a little bit more sense. Now, Goldenrod Brewery and I go back a long ways. I used to visit their brewery location almost weekly, so I'm very, very, very happy that they have created such a tasty beer. And at 6%, it's not necessarily a heavy hitter, but it's not messing around. And we all know the more percent we have for the holidays with our families, even in quarantine, the better. Oh, I can almost not hear my uncle. Now we have the BJ's Grand Cru, which I'm very excited about. This is the 20th anniversary edition, which means that it was let out in 2019. This is not the 2020 vintage, which who knows what that'll taste like the way the year's gone. Now, this is one of my favorite Belgian beers, actually, which is a little disappointing to say considering it's crafted by a restaurant, but BJ's makes pretty good beers. I got my start in the beer industry as a finished beer specialist for BJ's. Now, one of the great things that BJ's did when they decided to make a Belgian was they imported their Belgian malts, and they used some secret exotic spices that even I didn't know what they were. Now, this really strong Belgian-style ale presents a really sweet, malty character and pleasant little mixes of fruit and spice. This is also 10.5%, so if your holidays are really going poorly, turn to the Grand Cru. Now, this is packaged traditionally corked instead of capped. Nice little wisps of vapor coming off the top there, almost falling out of the bottle. Pouring my BJ's Grand Cru into my BJ's Grand Cru glass. Pours a bit of a translucent golden hue with a nice white head. Not too much foam though. I wonder if the carbonation on this has gone down since it's bottle conditioned. Now BJ's does suggest leaving the Grand Cru in a bottle for about a year or a year and a half in cellaring temperatures and light to fully bring out the best notes of this beer. So I'm hoping I'm going to get a nice complex Belgian from this. Ooh, this smells great. Getting three very distinct smells, and that's pretty much it. And that is clove, banana, and Belgian yeast. Oh man. That is some of the maltiest malt. I almost don't know how to explain. It's very caramely, thick on your tongue, but a very, very bready, malty taste. Cinnamon, nutmeg, allspice. It's like the trifecta of beer spices for some reason. Kind of like some of the older Belgian ales, but not too much. Now, a lot of people say they can taste plum in the Grand Cru, and I have not tasted plum before until now. There is a definite plum taste on the end. It's really smooth and creamy on the mouth. Like I said, it feels almost caramely in texture. I guess I'm glad that this was technically made in 2019 and released then instead of the alternative.
Last week I went over some nice Christmas holiday beers. This week, in honor of Hanukkah, I wanted to go over some cool Hanukkah beers. Turns out, there's not that many out there. So, we're gonna go with a holiday movie beer, a beer that's spelled sort of holiday in the text, Jewishness, and the single Hanukkah beer I could find. There's not many. Kicking things off, first up I have the Santa, I know him, elf reference, Festive Saison. Now, this is an extremely, extremely interesting Saison to me because it does not follow traditional Saison taste to me, to be perfectly honest. This is brewed by Evil Genius Beer Company, and it's coming in at 7.2%. Now, I normally also don't get Saisons from a can. It's interesting. It's a really nice color, almost like a dark mahogany, especially when you put it on a nice dark wood here. No head, no lace, there's no last, there's almost no carbonation. I could see a little bit there, but the haziness is really fighting that. Now, it smells a lot like floral, fruitiness, a little bit of like cellar must almost. Smells like it's been aged in an old place full of old barrels, but in a good way. I'm definitely getting the black currant and the dark Belgian candy syrup and that Belgian yeast they decided to use for it. So taste follows the smell. I'm definitely getting that kind of celery. I really wish I had a better way to describe the way that musty kind of just sits on your tongue. A little bit of cherry, a lot of floral flavors, a lot of winter spice in this almost, which makes a lot of sense considering it's a festive saison. It's a very muddled flavor. There's a lot of stuff in here. It's almost as if it wants to get the sourness you find in Saison sometimes, but it doesn't play well with the Belgian yeast they're using, and they've used what tastes like a lot of it. I mean, this tastes like the aftertaste, malty, kind of Belgian yeasty taste of a quad or a triple. Interesting. That has to be my first farmhouse holiday brew or holiday Saison that I've ever had. And Evodine is not bad. Next beer we have is from a brewery called Pizza Port. Now, they are a great brewery. They make a lot of different brews. They're from Carlsbad, California, so they're not too far away, at least from some of us. But the reason I chose this one is only because the Swami's is stylized and it looks almost like Hebrewish. It was the closest I could do. And I happen to know that Swami's IPA from Pizza Port is a delicious IPA. Now, this is one of the special beers for Pizza Port because it was the first beer that they made at their original location over 20 years ago. That is a light IPA. Now, Swami's is a West Coast IPA, which means there's a lot of citrus and pine notes in it. I happen to like West Coast IPAs. Maybe that's because I'm a West Coast guy. I like the pine. I like the pine smell. It's a very, very light golden hue. I'm used to my IPAs being a little bit darker, to be perfectly honest. Nice sticky foam. Really, really clings, really, really big lacing. A lot of citrus, a lot of pine resin. It's a really, really thick head, almost two fingers in an IPA glass. That's a pretty hefty head. That's almost a German beer head. Almost a spicy, kind of floral, tropical spice. That's a Swami's IPA. Very standard IPA. Mostly citrus, pine, little white pepper. The malt is a little bready, which is great. I love that. The hops are decent, but the bitterness is not too high. Ooh, yeah. Different flavors between the head and the actual beer itself, which mix very well. It's extremely, extremely thin, almost watery-like. Not thinking of water because the beer is, the taste is great. This is a special beer. If you like double IPAs, this is a great one to try if you haven't. It's a nice old school West Coast style IPA. A lot of citrus and a lot of pine, but it drinks like a session. Even though it's 6.8%, it's probably not. Now we've come to the company and the brewery that I really wanted to talk about. Schmaltz, or specifically their Hebrew line. I heard about these years ago, and they had a bunch of different styles, all made to celebrate Jewish culture. And growing up in a Jewish family and seeing that there was actually a Jewish beer was pretty cool. Schmaltz started out delivering their first 100 cases of beer out of the back of their grandmother's Volvo. Under their Hebrew brand, they currently are the only brewery specifically set out to celebrate Jewish culture and became a nationally distributed brew. From Funky Jubilation to their recent Shebrew line, they have a wide selection of styles, and most of them have really great, really funny Jewish-related joke titles. So this Hanukkah Golden Jelly Donut pastry beer, since it's a sweetened, almost a flavored malt beverage, to be perfectly honest. Almost no head to speak of. Very nice carbonation, though. Nice kind of reddish color, which makes a lot of sense. There's a Jewish tradition that dates back probably almost 1,500 years ago called Sufganiyot, which is a stuffed jelly donut, and they are traditionally eaten for Hanukkah. What makes this jelly donut brew the perfect stand-in for Sufganiyot for the holidays is that they actually use 600 pounds of real raspberry and cherry puree in every batch of the beer. Additionally, the pure vanilla that they use lends a really strong sweetness. Now, I smell a lot of raspberry and cherry, which makes sense, and almost the smell of a dark ale. It's thick and almost musty, like that cellar must I was talking about before. It smells like a dark ale should. Now, one of the great things about this beer and one of the great things about Schmaltz as a company is that when they make a beer and they give it a name or a reason, they make sure that it is through and through. This beer is brewed with 8 different types of malts, 8 different types of hops, and it comes out at 8%, making it the perfect beer to celebrate any of the 8 nights of Hanukkah. Definitely not a coincidence. It is extremely fruity. The raspberry taste is very, very strong. It almost bowls completely over the cherry, but the cherry does get back up and start running again because you can taste them right at the end. The little bit that sits on the back of the tongue that's almost barley wine-esque is just a very thick, heavy combination of flavors I can't quite place. The Dachshund Menorah, it's pretty cool. To start off with the Toppling Goliath, King Sue. Awesome can, always gonna love dinosaurs. Can't go wrong. It's pouring kind of a cloudy, dark yellowish color with a nice white foamy head, very pillowy. The head retention is extremely good. That's not going anywhere. Really, really strong pineapple and citrus. Maybe a hint of grapefruit. A little bit of grain, like sweet grain in the background. Not much malt at all. This is a great tropical IPA smell. The head's thick, but it's got a really nice citrus flavor to it. It's definitely gonna complement the beer. Starts off a little sweet with a bit of pineapple, maybe some orange, grapefruit. The flavors are pretty bold. They're very well pronounced. IPAs are described as juicy a lot of the time. This is juicy. This tastes like fruit juice beer in a good way. This is definitely a tropical IPA. And if you're into tropical IPAs or pineapple citrus flavors in your beers, I would absolutely encourage you to check this out already. This is impressive. Good job toppling Goliath. Like I said, I don't think you can go wrong with dinosaurs. Next up, we have the Humble Nord IPA from McKellar. Now, McKellar is not a brand I'm actually familiar with. They're based out of San Diego, and I have to say, first thing I've had the pleasure of trying from them. Pouring out a little hazy already. A murky orange sort of color. Not much head, not much carbonation. Not even a quarter finger of head. Very, very little head to this beer. Not too much lacing, but it's got a little bit of retention on the sides for lacing, so. Not gonna get a lot of flavor on its head. Getting pineapple again. A little bit of lime almost. Really juicy and tart. Interesting. Strange that it's going to be to say gooseberries come to mind. Maybe a little bit of coconut on the back end, but I'm getting a lot of almost chocolate stout type taste. A little bit of lychee. I really am getting that strong, almost chocolate though from this, which is a little surprising, but doesn't really detract from the beer. And I'm not a big chocolate stout person either, but it's working. This is about the definition of medium-bodied beer. A little juicy on the palate, moderate amount of carbonation, a lot of sediment in the bottom. A lot of sediment in the bottom, in fact. I will tell you right now, this does not taste like an IPA at all. There's a lot of tropical aromas and flavors. I gotta say, I didn't expect both of these to taste so tropical. That's a decent beer, but if you're into kind of chocolate stouts and want to branch out to an IPA, this is an IPA that doesn't taste anything like an IPA and has some very, very dark, chocolatey, malty flavors to it. Now, if you're here watching beer videos, you're likely no stranger to Stone Brewing. They make a line called their Enjoy by IPA, which I believe I have already featured once on this show. However, each one is slightly different. The reason why it's the Enjoy by series is each one is meant to be enjoyed within a specific amount of time. Waited about as long as you could for this one. Of course, a little bit hazy, not too hazy. 12-ounce bottle versus a 16-ounce can. It's a deep, bright orange color with really heavy white head. Not too much lacing. It doesn't really leave much behind. It clings to itself. It's very sticky. Getting peach, pineapple, citrus, maybe grapefruit, maybe orange, can't tell. Maybe some strawberry. Now, a lot of these flavors don't actually come from the fruits being used in the brewing, though I've definitely featured a few of those in the show so far, but from the hops that are used. For instance, a lot of the pineapple mango flavors that came out of the Toppling Goliath, the King Sue, weren't from being used from actual fruit, but from the citra hops that are used, which give it that citrus taste. So, getting a lot of flavors in here, but I'm doubting that any of that fruit was actually used to brew. A flavor follows the nose. Peach, pineapple, grapefruit, some sweetness that may or may not be that strawberry I was talking about. I can't quite. The finish is kind of sweet and a little bit of bitterness in the back of the tongue. This is a big-bodied IPA, a lot of pineapple and peach flavors to it. Kind of pulpy orange, I can't say texture, but feel. Slightly big at 9.4%. Hides the alcohol taste a little too much. And once more, we have the Stone Enjoy By coming in at 9.4%. The McKellar Humble Nord at 7.7%. And while it's not listed on the can, I do believe Toppling Goliath's King Sue comes in at about 7.5. So all these guys are technically considered heavy hitters, with the Enjoy By definitely being the strongest of the bunch. And yet, probably has the least strong alcohol taste of the bunch. So it's pretty impressive, Stone. That's a really great addition to the Enjoy By series. First up, we have Sam Smith's Organic Chocolate Stout. Now, I'm not a big stout person. I'm not a huge chocolate fan either, to be perfectly honest. I'm a little weird, sorry. But I kind of wanted to go out of my wheelhouse on this one. Considering Sam Smith is such an old brewery, I don't get too much account to try a lot of their stuff. Starts coming out a really nice amber color, very light, but as it gathers, man, that's black. That is nearly black. really, really sudsy foam. It's really, really heavy head. There's a lot of lacing left on the glass from the head too, and the head's really, really got good retention. It's not really going anywhere, which for a stout makes sense. A little bit of a metallic scent almost. I'm wondering if that's just due to the bottle or the age of the bottle. I'm not 100% sure how old the bottle is. But there's definitely a strong chocolate malt to this, which being a chocolate stout, makes sense. Now, I've had chocolate stouts before too, but I haven't had an organic chocolate stout before, so I'm wondering if there's gonna be any kind of palatable difference. Right up front, I can tell it's gonna taste a lot like chocolate. Oh man, okay. I'm gonna be honest, I really thought I was gonna be severely disappointed with this one, but it tastes like a liquid chocolate malt ball. Really intense dark chocolate kind of flavor, but not, there's a little bit of sweetness to it, so it's not quite dark chocolate, it's almost like a milk chocolate flavor, which is strange. Yeah, it's not like a chocolate bar or like a Tootsie Roll. Like the closest thing I can think of is a chocolate covered malt ball. There's a sweetness there, but it's not too much, even for a stout. The crazy thing is it's really not that thick either. It really slides down your throat really easily. If you like chocolate, you're probably gonna like this beer. If you don't, you may not. And I don't even like chocolate, to be honest, but this is more like a chocolate malt ball. So if you like chocolate malt balls, you're probably gonna like this. Sam Smith's Organic Chocolate Stout. I honestly think this tastes great. 4.5% alcohol. Next up, we have a great addition. Not specifically because of what it is, since I've never had it before, but because if you get gifted beer over the holidays like I do, you eventually have to go through them before they go bad. This is Ridgeway Brewing's Bad Elf. Now, this is part of an entire set of beers, including Bad Elf, Seriously Bad Elf, Very Bad Elf, Criminally Bad Elf, Reindeer Dropping, Santa's Butt, Lump of Coal Stout, etc. They have really fun bottles for the holidays as well. So this is actually a winter pale ale. I'm gonna be using a tulip glass for this. Just gonna want to, ooh, nice kind of golden copper color. Definitely more golden than copper, to be perfectly honest. That's pretty. 4.5% as well, just like the Samuel Smith Stout. The head's really puffy, but it's a lot of large bubbles, almost like a Stella or like a lager. A sour smell almost. You can smell the hops, but they're not really strong. There's spices, caramel. It almost smells like it's about to skunk too, which makes sense. The bottle is brown, but it's not quite dark enough to block all light, so. It's actually pretty nicely balanced. Nothing's really standing out as the dominant taste. Nothing's really overpowering. It's a little bit malty, and there's a little bit of hop on the back end of the taste, but almost a bitter citrus finish at the end of it. Kind of like almost chewing on like an orange or a lemon rind. It's pretty creamy. It's very wet too. It's very thin, just like the Samuel Smith was, to be honest. They're not, this is maybe a little bit thinner. So we go well with a lot of like German sausages, potato dishes. Carbonation's pretty low, to be honest. It's a solid British pale ale for winter. It's definitely worth it during the holidays, if only for the gag of the Christmas bottle. Last but not least on the list today is something I'm actually really excited to try. For those of you that know me and my wife Jen, who currently hosts the Geeky Juice Cocktail Show on Nom Talk Network, she has a wheat allergy. So I like to find beers that are gluten-reduced or gluten-free beers. Anything that's not made with sorghum, in my opinion, any of the beers that are made with sorghum taste absolutely vile. But Stone Brewing has actually made a few gluten-reduced options. Their Stone Delicious is a phenomenal IPA. However, coming in at 7.7%, it's a little bit stronger than she likes to drink a lot of the time. So I'm really excited to present the Stone Features and Benefits IPA. That Stone's doing the whole no stone unturned thing, so all their cans are upside down. So basically it's gluten reduced, super smooth, it's 95 calories, 2.9 grams of carbs, and only 4% alcohol. So, without further ado, let's get in our nice IPA glass here. We had a lot of good carbonation, so looking forward to that. They call this an insanely flavorful hop-forward IPA. So for 4%, that's actually, I'm hoping to be impressed like I was with Founders All Day IPA, which for a session IPA, a lot of flavor to it.
very, very light. A lot of lighter than a lot of IPAs. It's like a straw yellow. Really frothy whitehead, big bubbles. It smells like I don't want to say grassy, but it smells grassy. Like a herbal, kind of veggie, vegetable, meat smell. It's a little bit of citrus zest and fruit. For a hop-forward IPA, I'm not getting any hops on the nose. Okay, some citrus zest, a little bit of lemon, lime, kind of, ooh, tangerine. Damn, that's a lot of tropical in there, actually. Like tangerine and grapefruit, and that almost tasted like pear. There's a lot of fruit flavors in here, but it's really watery. It's not hop forward at all. It's not even hop backwards. It's hop negative. Really, really light body, super low carbonation. I'm not gonna lie, I'm a little disappointed in this one. I would not call this insanely flavorful, nor would I call it hop forward. And it's hurting me to have to call it an IPA. This honestly tastes like a session IPA had a baby with a Bud Light seltzer. Harsh words, I know. However, if you like a good session IPA with a very, very low, almost more like a pale ale instead of an India pale ale, but a lot lower of a hop bite, but a little bit of that tropical citrusness you get in those POGs, this might be a good bet for you. For myself, I think I'm all right. Today's a little bit of a special episode, as it's only gonna feature one beer, which I don't believe I've done before. This is a collaborative beer between two breweries that I hold in high esteem, one of which I've talked about extensively already on this series. Founded in 1996, Stone Brewing has grown to become the ninth largest craft brewer in the United States. This isn't to say they're the ninth best, though, as Beer Advocate magazine has called them the all-time top brewery on planet Earth twice since they started. Since closing down their Stone Berlin location, they run breweries in Escondido, California and Richmond, Virginia, as well as 9 taproom locations and Stone Distribution Company, the nation's largest craft-centric beer distributor. How big? Stone distributes to all 50 states and over 40 countries worldwide. That brings us to our second brewery, Modern Times. Now, Modern Times launched a small 30-barrel production brewery and taproom in San Diego in 2013, and is now distributed in more than 10 states, and boasts a growing barrel program and a chain of brewery, restaurant, and tasting room locations from San Diego to Portland. Now, they come from a group of coffee-loving beer drinkers, and as such, not only have a large amount of coffee-infused or flavored beers, but a full-on, critically lauded roasting and cafe program. In 2017, they were proud to announce themselves as California's first employee-owned brewery. News is that they are working on a megaplex in downtown Anaheim that will be a brewery, restaurant, cafe, and swim club, believe it or not, though I'm not entirely sure what that means. Now, Stone and Modern Times have a lot more in common than you may know. A core group of the Modern Times team came from Stone. In fact, CEO and founder of Modern Times, Jacob McKean, literally told his boss at Stone he was leaving to start his own brewery. Indeed, Stone Brewing Distributing Company is the Modern Times SoCal distributor still to this day. That's not the only thing they have in common. Both organizations also belong to the Hop Quality Group, a group of craft breweries dedicated to the maintenance and improvement of hop quality, which I support greatly. This isn't the first time they've worked together either, and in fact they made a huge collaborative effort to create the San Diego Brewers United Double IPA. They didn't involve just Stone and Modern Times though. They also included Alesmith, Mother Earth, Pizza Port, Port Brewing, and Thorn Brewing, all San Diego native breweries. That brings us to this Modern Times Stone Brewing collaboration. Wizards and Gargoyles Hazy Coffee IPA. Now for those of you who are just tuning in, I'm not a big coffee fan, but I've had this beer recommended to me by multiple friends who say the coffee taste really isn't that poignant, and a lot of what you get is the grain. So I'm willing to try. I love Modern Times, and I love Stone. Even if Modern Time loves coffee, and I don't. So I'm definitely down to try this. The bottle shows a really fun 1980s 8-bit arcade style look, which I tend to love, considering that's my jam. This is brewed with Centennial, Cashmere, Citra, and Azaka hops, as well as 2 hops that I believe are currently still in development. The coffee Modern Times decided to use this features kind of a blueberry and melon taste, so I'm really looking forward to trying it, which I usually don't say about coffees. A little lighter color than I expected for a coffee anything, to be perfectly honest. I kind of expected a black IPA or at least a dark IPA, but it's got pretty decent carbonation. A little bit lower than I would have expected, but not bad. The head's got a very thick, kind of foamy marshmallow texture to it almost. I think it'll probably leave some pretty decent lacing once we get to drinking. I smell lemon and dry coffee grounds. And while I hate coffee, my wife doesn't, that's how I know how that smells like. A touch of fruitiness, maybe pineapple and some other citrus taste. Could be orange. I can definitely smell the coffee here, but it's way toward the back end. It's not even a forward note at all. Overall, for someone who's not a coffee drinker, not a bad smell. Let's give it a taste. Getting a lot of citrus orange kind of mixed with the coffee. There's a little tartness maybe from lemon or grapefruit. Kind of adds to the overall complexity though. Following the nose, the taste of the coffee kind of takes a back seat to the grain and a lot of that crisp citrus taste. You can definitely taste the alcohol on the back end, but at 7%, that's not much of a surprise. Mouth goes light with a lot of, honestly, a lot more of a carbonation feel than I expected from the bubbles I saw raising from the bottom of the IPA glass here. You can almost feel the coffee grounds and citrus peel as you drink it, which isn't to say that it's grainy. It's almost like the taste lends to your imagination really strongly. As someone not normally into coffee, or, you know, absolutely hates coffee, this one surprised me. Keeping the coffee taste to the back and letting it build to kind of a linger instead of hitting you right straight in the taste buds with an overwhelming taste of coffee was the right way to go here, in my opinion. Now, again, I'm not a large coffee fan, so if you are, this may have a different taste to you, or this may be a different experience to you, or you may not think that it has coffee enough, and you may go for one of modern times' stronger coffee tastes. Now, the grain tastes are really forward of the tastes here, and I'm a big fan of that. Grain outweighing the coffee really makes this a decent beer for me. And while this may not make my regular list, I'm pretty impressed and pretty pleased with the outcome. I'm a big fan of Stone and a big time fan of Modern Times, so I'm really glad this collaboration worked well. Now, I'm gonna try and get that San Diego Brewers and United double IPA, because I pretty much love all those breweries as well. I'm pretty happy with Stone plus Modern Times. I'm Dustin, your friendly neighborhood giant. And thank you so much for joining me for another episode of BrewTall Geek on Nom Talk Network. Like, comment, and subscribe.
Because drinking is always better with friends.